In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God.
He said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover.
You may be seated. It's great to be here tonight. And the way it worked out, we're trying to take a few days off after General Conference, and then I was supposed to take a trip I was invited to take a trip to the valley, to the border, to look at the religious leaders looking at the security of the border, but that has been postponed. So Brother Shaw found out I was going to be here tonight and asked if I would talk to you. So I'm going to talk to you tonight. We're going to talk about the one true God, the Almighty God in Jesus Christ. And this is an important topic and something that we as Apostolic Pentecostal believers, this is one of our signature doctrines or messages. And so I'd like for you to take a look at it with an open heart and an open Bible, and let's see what the Lord will do. I've given a couple of scriptures to the people that do the projection, but I told them I'm going to quote or refer to a lot, so just try to keep up if you want to. So if you can't, fine. If you can, that's great. But we're going to start with Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 4. When we talk about the doctrine of God, obviously that's foundational. You know, if you're going to study any religion, the first thing you want to know is what is their concept of God? Who do they worship? You can't get more basic than that. And so we're going to start. And we start with the Old Testament. Although we believe that the New Testament is greater revelation, the Old Testament is the foundation. So it's like if you want to read Shakespeare, you have to learn your ABCs long before you can read Shakespeare. Now, when you read Shakespeare, that's going to be much more exalted than a first grade or second grade reader, but you're still going to have to know your ABCs. If you're going to study calculus, you still have to know arithmetic, and 1 plus 1 is still going to equal 2 even when you get to calculus. So while the New Testament is the superior revelation and more directly applicable to us today, the New Testament talks about God, but who is God? Well, the Old Testament has already defined God, and both Testaments are true, so one Testament is not going to contradict the other. So what we learn in the basics in the Old Testament, that becomes the definition or the context for more understanding. And if you think about it, that's exactly how the early church learned. The apostles didn't have the New Testament. They wrote the New Testament. The early church didn't have the New Testament. What did they learn from? The Old Testament. That was their Bible. What did Jesus use to teach the apostles? And what did the apostles use to preach from in the early church? Our Old Testament. And that's how God chose to reveal truth. From the Old Testament is the foundation leading into the New Testament. So we're going to follow that same pattern here tonight. We're starting with Deuteronomy 6:4, which says simply, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And here is the foundation. Even to this day, the Jews of every type, from very ultra-Orthodox to conservative to reform to liberal, if you're going to be a practicing Jew or a believing Jew, at the minimum, you have to make this confession. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. There's only one God. That's foundational. That was a revolutionary message because in the ancient world, people believed in many gods and goddesses. And so God was getting the attention of his people. Hear, O Israel, listen to this. This will change your life. This is different from everyone else. You're going to be different from the rest of the world because other people have many gods and many lords, but for you, there's only one Lord. There's only one God. You'll notice if you're reading from the King James or even the New King James that Lord is in capitals, signifying that the underlying Greek, or the Hebrew text in this case, is the word Yahweh, or sometimes in English we traditionally have said Jehovah. Actually, nobody knows the exact ancient pronunciation. because ancient Hebrew did not write down their vowels. They just wrote down the consonants. And so the actual consonants, the four consonants, YHWH, that was the sacred name of God in the Old Testament. That was the unique name by which the true God identified himself in contrast to all the false gods. So the word God is generic. Every nation had a God. But what was the name of the God? That would distinguish who he was. The word Yahweh, it apparently, when you study it, it comes from the Hebrew verb to be. And it means he is. In other words, the application of he's the eternal one. The one who is and always will be. The one who has no beginning and no ending. It connects to what God told Moses in Exodus chapter 3 when Moses said, who should I say is sending me to deliver Israel from bondage and slavery in Egypt? And God said, you tell them, I am that I am. You tell them, I am is my name. And of course, that connects because that's the first person. When God is speaking of himself, he says, I am. When his people identify him, we say he is. And so that name Yahweh is connected to the name I am. It's two different forms of the same name. So you could actually translate this literally as, hear, O Israel, Yahweh is our God. Yahweh is one. So he's not just the God for our nation. He's the only God. He's the only true God. And that's the foundation. If you continue reading through verse 9, what you'll see is God wanted his people to emphasize this truth at every opportunity. So he said, I want you to put it before your forehead and put it on your forearm. The Orthodox Jews today take this command literally. So they have a little box, and in the box they have this passage of Scripture, and they will put it on a cord and wrap it around their arm and wrap it around their forehead. They don't do it in the synagogue because they have the Torah or the scrolls there, but in their privacy of their home, whenever they do private prayer, they put on what is called the tefillin, or in the New Testament King James, the phylacteries. These little boxes of Scripture, it's to remind them when they pray. It's a visible, tangible reminder on their forearm and on their forehead. When you pray, you're praying only to Jehovah or Yahweh. You're not praying to anyone else. And then he said, put it on your doorpost. Again, the Orthodox Jews take this very literally. If you go into an Orthodox Jewish home or even a store, if you go down New York City and you go to a store that's owned by a Jewish person, you will typically see this little scroll-shaped container attached to the door. Or if you go to Jerusalem to a hotel, as you walk into your hotel room, you'll find this little scroll-shaped container, the mezuzah, because they're trying to remind themselves at every opportunity. It says, when teach it to your children, when you rise up, when you walk about, when you sit down, when you go to bed at night, teach them there's only one God. And it's not just an academic exercise. Verse 4 says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Then verse 5 continues, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, thy soul, with all thy might. And so in other words, you are to worship him. You are to have a relationship with him. You're to devote yourself to him. So God is not an abstract, impersonal force. He's a personal being that you can have a relationship with. God is not a multiplicity of gods like the ancient Greeks and Romans thought. If you study mythology or basically any other religion that has a plurality of gods, the gods fight one another. And humans are trying to get on the good side of their favorite god, and they hope their god will help them against the other gods. But that's all a false concept. There's only one, and you're to have a relationship with him. It's kind of like a marriage. You get that close personal relationship is predicated on you as an individual in relationship with one person. And that's who God is. Now, let me fast forward to the New Testament. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 8 through verse 10. Colossians chapter 2, verse 8 through verse 10. And here we find what the New Testament adds to the Old Testament. The New Testament, of course, reveals Jesus Christ. And it says, Colossians 2:8, "Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power." So, there's first of all a warning that someone could spoil you. And here, that term is used like an army spoiling a city. So someone could rob you, could strip you, could take away your treasures. How could that happen? Through human philosophy and traditions of men, human traditions. Now, not all philosophy is bad, not all traditions are bad. But there is a danger when you follow human philosophy or human teaching and human traditions instead of God's Word, then that's when you get off track. Now, if the tradition you're handing down is God's Word, you're in good shape. Or if the philosophy that you're studying is about God, then you're on the right track. But if it's human philosophy that goes away from the Word of God, or it's human traditions that pass down beliefs that are not in the Word of God, then what's going to happen? You're going to be robbed of your treasure. So how do you avoid that? What's the alternative? The alternative is to follow after Jesus Christ. And the reason why is found in verse 9. Colossians 2:9 is a key verse. For in him, that's Jesus Christ. If you read the previous few verses, Christ Jesus the Lord, that's how you're saved. So in Christ Jesus the Lord dwells, present tense, all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Now let's just break that down for a moment. When it says bodily, that means Jesus Christ was a real human being, of flesh and blood. He wasn't just a vision, a dream, an appearance, or what we call in the Old Testament a theophany, or visible manifestation of God. At times in the Old Testament, God would appear in a visible form, an angelic form or a human form, but then he would disappear. It was just temporary. It wasn't a flesh and blood person. It was just an appearance to the senses. Jesus is more than that. He is actually a human being with flesh and blood who bled and died bodily. But he's more than just a human, because the Bible says the Godhead bodily. Now that word Godhead is an unusual word. The Greek form is found only in this one place in the entire Bible. And what it means is the total of God's nature. It's everything that makes God who he is. The Godhead means all of God's attributes, characteristics, personality, nature. So basically what this saying, Jesus is both God and man at the same time. He is the Godhead bodily. Now you might say, well, you know, God is a spirit. God is everywhere. He's omnipresent. That means, you know, if you go to China, God's already there. If you go to the moon, God's there. So how could God's infinite, omnipresent spirit be crammed into a physical body? Well, notice, we're not saying the infinite God can be restricted to a physical location. But we're saying God's personality, God's character, God's quality is in Jesus Christ. The Godhead is in Jesus Christ. It doesn't take away from his omnipresence. It just says the full character and identity of God is revealed in Jesus Christ. Now, if that seems hard to understand, think of it this way. Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. If you study the Scripture, the only person who could be our Savior is someone who could take our place. So we, all of us that sin, we deserve to die for our sins. So in the Old Testament, they offered animal sacrifices. But the book of Hebrews says animals couldn't really take our place. Animals couldn't pay the price for our sins. So it required someone who was fully human in every way, just like us, except without sin, who did not deserve to die. He could step in and take our place. He could take the punishment of our sins, and he could die for us. So our Savior had to be fully human, just like us. The Bible talks about him being the lamb that sacrificed for our sins. It talks about him being our kinsman redeemer. He's someone who is related to us, who has the right to come speak for us and pay the price for us. But if he was only a man, there'd be a big problem. First of all, how could he be a sinless human being? But there's another problem. If he's simply a man, let's say he was the only man that never sinned, but just a human, well, maybe he could take my place, but how could he take my place and your place? How could he take the place of millions of people? He couldn't. And if he died and he was in the tomb, but then he rose again the third day, he's not dead any longer. How does that pay the price for my eternity? How could 3 days take care of my eternity? If he was only a man, he couldn't pay the price. But because he was the infinite God manifested in the flesh, when he took on the penalty of our sins, the infinite God could cover every human being that ever lived who would turn to him in faith. And the infinite God could take care of the eternal payment or punishment because he's taken upon himself. In other words, what you find out when you think it through, the only one who could be our Savior had to be both human and God at the same time. Not only that, who has the power and authority to forgive sins? The Bible says only God has that right. So in order to die, to shed blood, to take our place, he had to be human. But in order to have the power and authority to take away our sins and pay the price for the whole world for all eternity, he had to be God. And so it's essential to understand who Jesus is, the Godhead bodily. Now, some have a hard time of thinking about that, and they think of Jesus as a human, and he prayed to God, and so maybe there must be God somewhere else. So maybe Jesus is a junior God, or a second person, or maybe he's part of God. Maybe one part of God was in heaven, the other part of God is in earth. But you can't divide God like that. You think of the Godhead, that's perfection. I mean, I think we'd all agree one of the characteristics of being God is you're perfect. If God wasn't perfect, he wouldn't be God, right? That's the definition. So, if God is perfect, you can't add anything to him, because then he must not have been perfect if you could add some more to him to make him more perfect. You're either perfect or you're not. And likewise, you cannot take away something from God and him still be God, because if he's perfect and you take away part of him, he's no longer complete. He's no longer perfect. So, if you think about it, the very identity of God as perfect and complete means he can't be split up into little pieces where part of God's over here and part of God's over there. He's either God or he's not God. So you can't say Jesus is a little part of God or one-third of God or one of several persons, because the very definition of God goes against that. And what we just saw in the Old Testament, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, not two, not three, not 50, but one. So, if you're still struggling with that, notice it says the fullness of the Godhead. So the Apostle Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, has already anticipated our human reasoning, where he said, oh, Jesus is the Godhead body. Okay, I get it. He must be one of those persons that came down to earth. No, the fullness of the Godhead. Everything God is in Jesus, the fullness of the Godhead. And if you're still struggling, okay, the fullness, but maybe there's other fullness. Then he's got another word, all the fullness. So he's ahead of you. No matter how you try to limit God or reduce God, it doesn't work. Because in Jesus Christ dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So you want to know who Jesus is? Jesus is God. Now, somebody may jump ahead and say, well, but wait a minute, if he's God, how did he pray? Who is he praying to? Well, it certainly wasn't one part of God praying to another part of God, because we've already described, you can't divide God up. And if one part of God could pray, then that part needed help. That part was weak. Well, that part wasn't God, because by definition, if God is weak and needs help, well, he's not God. But what you find is Jesus was a true human being in every way, just like us, except he never sinned. And if you think about it, when God created Adam and Eve, they were the first humans, the true humans. He didn't create them in sin. They later chose sin. When Jesus comes as a human being, he doesn't come as a fallen human, a marred human. He comes like an original human, the way God originally created humans. So you might say he's a little bit more human than we are, because he's perfect human and we're not. Okay, so if you think about it from that perspective, Jesus was a real human being, just like us. So think of it this way. In every way that we relate to God, Jesus, as a human, had to be able to relate to God. If he couldn't, he wasn't a real human. The only thing is, since he never sinned, he didn't need to repent, he didn't need to be born again. But he didn't need to be baptized to wash away his sins. But he got baptized anyway, the Bible says, to fulfill all righteousness. In other words, to identify with us. He didn't need to receive the Holy Ghost because he was in spirit, already full of the Holy Ghost. But yet, when he was baptized, the Spirit came upon him. Why? To anoint him. But notice what he was doing. He was setting a pattern for us to follow. If he, who didn't need to be baptized, yet obeyed and was baptized, he who didn't need any new anointing of the Spirit, yet submitted himself to the anointing of the Spirit, obviously, we need to be baptized and we need to receive the Holy Spirit. Praise God. So he prayed because he was human. The shocking thing would actually be if he didn't pray. Because how could you be a human, a righteous human, and not obey God, and not pray, and not submit yourself to God? That wouldn't even make sense. So the prayers of Christ do not prove that he's a second person or that he's a lesser deity. They prove he's human. And if you're still having a problem understanding, well, who did he pray to? Did he pray to himself? No, because Jesus was different than every other human. He was both human and divine at the same time. You can't speak of him in the same way without considering that he's both human and divine at the same time. But maybe we can draw an analogy. Most of us here today, we've received the Holy Ghost. We have God's Spirit inside of us. And we can feel God's presence anywhere. We don't have to come to church. But there are times where we feel lonely, right? There are times we feel discouraged. Now, God's in us, but yet we feel that separation. And we pray. Even though we know God dwells in us, as humans, we pray to God in heaven. Now, we're not God. We're not like Jesus. But if we can have the experience of knowing that the Spirit of God dwells in us, and yet we feel the need to pray, and yet we feel lonely and discouraged at different times, well, then Jesus could undergo that same human experience. You just have to remember, in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So the right way to explain it is Jesus, as a human, prayed to God. At the same time, remember, God was in Christ. And so what we have is the one true God who came in the flesh for our salvation. Now, let me go back and underscore this, because I think we have to appreciate how significant the idea of the oneness of God is. It's not something we can casually overturn or ignore. If you go to Isaiah chapter 43, I'll just give you some simple examples. There's no way that we can cover all this subject tonight. But Isaiah 43, and I'll read verse 10 through verse 11. Isaiah 43:10, "Ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I, even I, am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior." So notice some very strong statements where the Lord, or Yahweh, Jehovah, is saying, I'm the only God. There's no one beside me. There's no one before me. There's no one after me. There's no Savior beside me. Okay, now let's go to Isaiah 44. verse 6. Isaiah 44:6. Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel, his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, I am the last. Beside me, there is no God. And then Isaiah 44, same chapter, verse 8. Isaiah 44:8. Fear ye not, neither be afraid. Have not I told thee from that time and have declared it? Ye are even my witnesses. Is there a God beside me? Yea, there is no God. I know not any. The next chapter, still in 44, this time verse 24. Thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, he that formed thee from the womb. I am the Lord that maketh all things, that stretcheth forth the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. So he says, when I created the universe, I did it alone, and I did it by myself. Now I want you to notice there's a theme here that there's only one God. Now, if you just use the word one generically, you might say, well, what does that mean? One in union. You know, like husband and wife, they're two persons, but they're one flesh, the Bible says. They work together. They're in union. But God is not merely using the term one in a generic way or symbolic or figurative way. He's meaning it in a very literal, numerical way. Because notice the kind of words, alone, by myself. So I could say, you know, my wife and I are one flesh, but, you know, she's not feeling well tonight, she's at home. So I can't say, even though we're one flesh, I can't say we're one person. Because I'm right now here tonight, I'm alone and by myself. She's not here. So God is using terms that transcend an idea of unity or agreement or a council of deities that work together. He's using absolute terms. I'm the first. I'm the last. The implication is I'm everything in between. You know, there's no one before me. There's not going to be anybody after me. There's nobody beside me. No one on the left side. No one on the right side. You know, I'm the only one you're going to see. I'm alone. I'm by myself. So he's using the strongest possible numerical language to exclude plurality. And then, of course, when you go to the New Testament, we know that Jesus is described as the Savior. And that creates a paradox until you think it through. If Yahweh in the Old Testament says, I'm the only Savior, Jesus in the New Testament says, I'm the Savior. Who's right? If they're two different persons, one's right, the other's wrong. The only way they can both be right is if Jesus is the one true God manifested in the flesh to be our Savior. And if you want to do that exercise, what's interesting, if you take every, you just read through the Old Testament, especially passages like Isaiah, Psalms, that give titles for God, and you list all the titles for God. He's the shepherd, he's the rock, he's the light, he's the first, he's the last, he's the king, he's the judge, he's the redeemer, he's the savior. You just go on and on. And then you go to the New Testament. The New Testament gives every single one of those titles to Jesus. So, if you don't want to take the time, just get my book, The Oneness of God, and I have some tables that have it all spelled out. You can look it over and look at the scriptural references. All right. Going a little bit further, Isaiah 45, verse 5 through verse 6. I am the Lord, there is none else. There is no God beside me. I girded thee, though thou hast not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun from the west, there is none beside me. I am the Lord, there is none else. How about this? Isaiah 45:21-23. Tell ye, and bring them near, yea, let them take counsel together. Who hath declared this from ancient time? Who had told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, there is none else. I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness, and shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. So this is another just absolute statement. The Lord, Jehovah, Yahweh, I'm the only Savior. If you're going to be saved, you have to come to me. And in the end, every knee is going to bow to me. Every tongue is going to swear or confess to me. Now, what's really interesting, when you go to the New Testament in Philippians chapter 2, the Apostle Paul quotes this very oneness verse and applies it to Jesus and says, in the end, at the last judgment, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So how is Jehovah going to fulfill this? At the name of Jesus. When the name of Jesus is mentioned, every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess. We won't be denying God. We'll be confessing God because God chose to reveal himself to the human race in the name of Jesus. So Jesus is the name of revelation. Okay. Now, somebody may be thinking, well, okay, one God, that sounds great. But doesn't the Bible talk about the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? And of course, the Bible does. But you always have to go back and let the Bible define its own terms. The problem we have living in the 21st century is we've had 20 centuries of development of human philosophy and traditions. So when we read a phrase, we automatically read it from our perspective. But what we need to do is read it from the perspective of the Bible when it was written. So, for example, these terms, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, become prominent in the New Testament, the first century. So instead of looking at what these terms mean to theologians of the 21st century, we should look at what they meant to the apostles in the first century. So if you break it down, and I only have a little time tonight, but first of all, you take the term Father. Father is a term of relationship. Father indicates the source of life, origin. So, I've got three kids. They're all grown and married. I'm their father. I'm the one that caused them to be begotten. So, I'm before them. I'm the cause. I gave them life. I have a relationship with them. Now, before they were born, before my first son, Jonathan, was born, I wasn't a father. But when he was born, suddenly I became a father. Now, I didn't become a new person. I didn't split into two persons. But I entered into a new relationship. So throughout the Bible, when you see the term God, the Father, it's always talking about God in relationship to the human race or to the spirit realm. He's called the Father of spirits because he created every spirit being. He's called the Father of humans because he created all humans. He's called the Father of the nation of Israel because he created the nation of Israel. He's called the Father of believers because by the new birth, he becomes our spiritual father. He's in a special way the father of the baby born of Mary because no human caused the conception. But by a miracle, God caused the conception. So God is the Father of the Son. Notice all those are terms of relationship. So we could say when the Bible says God the Father, it's not a different person from Jehovah or Yahweh, the terms we've read already. It's simply describing that one God in his relationship to us. Now, the term Holy Spirit, God is a spirit, and God is holy. In fact, God's the only one who's holy in and of himself. Anyone else who's holy, it's because they're in relationship with God. The Bible speaks of God over 50 times as the Holy One. Interesting, it never says the Holy Two, the Holy Three, Holy Four, anything like that. It's always the Holy One. Okay, so when we say the Holy Spirit, there's really only one who qualifies. Absolutely. That's God. So you might say, well, I mean, why even say Holy Spirit if it's just God? Because when we say the Holy Spirit, it's speaking of God in his spiritual essence and his spiritual action. Look at the very first mention of the Spirit of God. Now, that's often a good way to when you want to understand certain terms, look at the first time it's mentioned in the Scripture and build it from there, and you'll see the significance. So, Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Verse 2 says, the earth was without form, void, darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water. So when it wants to talk about God in action, it says God's Spirit. So when we say the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost, those are equivalent terms, or the Spirit of God, we're speaking of the one God as he interacts with us as he acts in the world and he acts in our life. It's not a different person from God the Father. It's just two different ways of looking at God. So when we're thinking of our relationship, we say, our Father who art in heaven. That's how Jesus starts to pray, because we're thinking of our relationship with God. But when we're thinking about God moving in our lives, we say, I receive the Holy Ghost, or I receive the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God moves here. You know, I could say, well, the Father is moving here tonight. The Father showed up here tonight. But that's unusual terminology, because instinctively you start looking around. Okay, where is he? But if I say the Holy Spirit is here tonight, the Holy Spirit is moving, well, then you understand I'm talking about the invisible presence and action of God. So the terminology is significant to help us understand how God works and God moves. Now, okay, how about the Son of God? Well, there is a scriptural definition of the Son of God. It's found in Luke 1 and 35. And this is when the angel Gabriel appeared to Mary and told her that she would have a child as a virgin. And so here's what he said in Luke 1:35. The angel answered, said to her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore, also that holy thing, or that holy child, which shall be born of thee, shall be called the Son of God. So here's why Jesus is called the Son of God. Because God was his Father. Because God overshadowed his mother and caused her to conceive by a miracle. So when we say the Son of God, we're actually meaning God manifested in the flesh. Never does the Bible say second person. It never says eternal Son. It never says God the Son. It always says the Son of God, or the only begotten Son of God. It's speaking of the true human being who's God manifest in the flesh. So, thumbnail version, when you say God the Father, you're saying God in relationship to the human race. When you say the Son, you're saying God manifested in the flesh. When you say the Holy Spirit, you're saying God in spiritual action in our lives. But you're still talking about one God, not three gods, not three persons, but one God. And we want to speak for sometimes said, well, you deny the Father and all that. No, we actually emphasize Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Here's why. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are not three eternal persons, as if God is divided, sitting three bodies and three thrones in heaven. That would be three gods. But God works in our lives as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit for the purpose of redemption. It's not the internal nature of God that we're talking about. It's God's redemptive manifestations for our benefit. In other words, we've already discussed this, but in order for humans to be saved, the Son of God had to be born, suffer, die. But in order for the Son of God to be born, no human could be the Father. God had to be the Father. So when you see the terms Father and Son, there is an important distinction, but not of two different persons. The distinction is trying to emphasize that Jesus was a real human being. And so as the Son, he was born. God as God can't be born. God as God can't die. God as God can't shed blood. But the Son of God could be born, could suffer, could shed blood, and die. But in order for the Son of God to be born, God had to be the Father. So that's why you need the Father and the Son. But Jesus died and rose again 2,000 years ago. How does that apply to our lives today? God comes to us by his Spirit. So God is Father, Son, and Spirit for the purpose of our salvation. But nowhere does the Bible use the term three persons or Trinity. And those terms mean different things to different people. Sometimes theologians use gymnastics to try to say, well, when we say three persons, we don't mean three persons like you think of three persons. And I always think, well, then why use the term then? If you use this term and then spend a whole book writing about how it's not what you think it means, well, why are you even using it?
if the Bible used it, then you would have to figure out how to explain it. But since the Bible doesn't use it, since it confuses most people, it leads them astray. It leads them away from understanding who Jesus really is. It's an old question, but it's still valid. Do you think of Jesus? Is Jesus in the Godhead? Or is the Godhead in Jesus? And of course, the Bible answers the Godhead is in Jesus. The Godhead is not an abstract substance that different people could have. The Godhead is the one God. So you can't even imagine what would that mean to say Jesus is in the Godhead. What's the Godhead then? Some substance that Jesus is in? No. The Godhead, if you're going to think of the character, quality, and attributes of God, is in Jesus. It's personalized. In other words, our Creator became our Savior. And this is why it makes such a big difference. Because when people think of three different persons, some of them think they're going to go to heaven and see three different beings on three different thrones. Well, of course, the book of Revelation shows there's only one throne, and Jesus is the one you're going to see on the throne. But it confuses people because they don't know who to pray to. They don't know who they're worshiping. They don't know who they're going to see in heaven. But here's the oneness of God explains what's really going on. The God who created us loved us so much that when we fell into sin, He could have just destroyed us. He could have started all over at some other point, but He didn't. He loved us so much, He designed a plan of salvation. God did not send somebody else to save us. God came Himself. God gave of Himself. When the Bible says He gave His only begotten Son, that means God came in the flesh, and as a human being, He laid down His human life for our sins. So our Creator has become our Savior. And not only that, He sends His Spirit to dwell inside of us to empower us today. Think about how beautiful that is. When you study how people learn, the first way you can learn is you can be told something. And that has value, but let's say you're trying to teach a little child how to write the ABCs, how to write the letter A. So you say, okay, the letter A, draw a slanted line. And then draw another slanted line connected at the top. And put a bar in the middle to connect them. There, you got it. How many kids are going to understand that and follow that? Not very many. So there's a better way. You can show them how. If they watch this. Here, here, here. And so some kids will probably be able to watch that and do it. But still, when they first try, just looking at something is really not going to help that much. So then, you can tell them how, you can show them how, but the best way is to do it with them. So you put your hand in their hand, you put the pencil, and you trace the letter A. And you say, okay, you try it. And so our God told us how to live. That's why we have the Old Testament. But you know what? For some reason, we as fallen humans have had a really difficult time living up to the law. So God came in flesh and showed us this is how it's done. We see Jesus. We read His wise words. They're amazing. But you know what? Just hearing about Jesus and watching Jesus and reading about Jesus, that we still fall short. We try to imitate Him. What would Jesus do? But just going through that, that still doesn't make us holy. But when we're baptized in Jesus' name, our sins are washed away. When we're filled with the Holy Spirit, we have the Spirit of God living inside of us. And now He works in us and through us and with us so that we can live the life that He wants us to live. That's why the message of the oneness of God is so important. Because if you divide up God's works, over here is the Father, over here is the Son, over here is the Holy Ghost. Well, who's going to help you? Who should you pray to? Who should you worship? Which one of us is you know, should we, some say, well, you know, talk to the Son and he'll, you know, the Father's going to judge you, but if you can get the Son on your side, then he can give us the Father. And some religions say, no, talk to the Son's mother because, you know, a son will never turn down the request of his mother. And so pray to Mary, she'll convince Jesus, and then Jesus will convince his Father, and then you'll be okay. But that's all confusion. There's only one God, and I'm glad we can go directly to God in the name of Jesus Christ, because that same God who can forgive our sins has paid the price for us. And when he forgives us, he will fill us with his Spirit, and we can live for him. Praise God. So the oneness of God puts it all together. Now, there are many other passages we could use, but I will give you a few in passing to show who Jesus really is, God manifest in the flesh. Now, the Bible presents Jesus as a true human being. And the apostles didn't, when they first met Jesus, they didn't fully understand who he was. But as they walked with him, heard him teach, saw the miracles that he did, it gradually began to dawn on them. But put yourself in their shoes. They were Jews that believed in only one God, or maybe in their sandals. And, you know, they weren't just going to one day say, oh, he's God. Hey, that guy over there that we ate lunch with, that's God, you know that? And that would have been incredible, foreign. But when they watched him, he began to teach. They say, I've never heard anybody teach like this. He speaks with authority. And they say, I've never felt what I feel. And then when he says, I forgive your sins, wait a minute. Only God can do that. Is this guy a lunatic? Is he a deceiver? What's he going around telling people their sins are forgiven? And Jesus said, hey, I heard what you were thinking. So then that itself, wait a minute, who can read your mind? He says, I know you're having questions about whether I can forgive sin. Well, watch this. If you think that's hard, here's the layman here. Rise up and walk. And the layman jumps up and walks, or the paralyzed man. Okay, what do you think about that? And they're in the midst of the storm, and Jesus steps up and says, peace, be still. And the winds and waves obey. And then he walks on the water. Then he takes five loaves and two fish, and he multiplies it and feeds 5,000 men plus women and children. And the more he does it, they begin to say, wait a minute. Only God can control nature. Only God can create. Only God can forgive sin. Only God can raise the dead by his own authority. You know, there are other prophets who prayed and called on the name of Yahweh, and God would do a miracle, but it's obvious God was doing it, but Jesus just walks on and rebukes the demon. He doesn't say, in the name of Yahweh, get out. He says, I command you, leave. Now, Lazarus, come forth. Who can just raise the dead like that? But the climactic moment was when he rose from the dead. Because you could explain away everything else, but there's no way to explain a man that you saw crucified, died, placed in a tomb, sealed up, and then he walks back out alive. And you remember, he said, well, in 3 days, you can destroy this temple. 3 days, I'll raise it up. And he wasn't talking about the physical temple, he was talking about his body. So, I'll just leave you with this one piece of evidence since we're out of time. But, well, I'll give you two. First one, John 14. Philip was getting pretty close, and he said, you know, you keep talking about the Father. Jesus said, yeah, you've seen the Father. Philip says, of course, this is a paraphrase, but you can read it, John 14. Philip says, I don't think so, Lord. If you actually show him to us, then I'll be satisfied. Jesus said, how can you ask such a question? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And if you can't believe what I'm saying, believe what I've been doing, and you'll know the Father dwells in me. In other words, Philip, God is an invisible spirit. How do you ask to see God with your physical eyes? The only way that could ever happen is if God manifested himself in some physical form. So look what I've been doing the last 3 years. Look what I've been teaching the last 3 years. I'm doing things that only God could do. So when you see me, you see the Father in the only way that human eyes could see the Father, because the Father is manifested in me. So I like to say when you get to heaven, everybody agrees we'll see Jesus. But if somebody thinks they're going to see another person called the Father, well, I imagine you go to Jesus and say, well, you know, it's so wonderful to see you. Praise you, Jesus. We love you and all that. And he said, well, where's your Father? Take me to your Father. Jesus can't change his words. He'd have to tell you the same thing you told Philip. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? And then I'll close with this, John 20. So, Jesus rises from the dead and appears to the apostles without Thomas. They're convinced. I mean, after all, he comes back from the dead. You know, that's more than amazing. So they all tell Thomas, and Thomas says, no way. I wouldn't believe that unless I could actually put my fingers in the stars of his hands. So Jesus obliges. He appears the next week, and here's Thomas. And Jesus says, okay, Thomas, I heard what you said. Come see me. Come touch me. Put your fingers in the holes of my hands. And what did Thomas say? He was a Jew. He was trained, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. When he saw the undeniable evidence, he didn't even have to touch the scars. He said, my Lord and my God. That's the climax of the book of John. We who read it are supposed to come to the same conclusion because Jesus said, you're blessed because you see and believe. Blessed are those who haven't seen and yet believe. And that's us. We've never seen Jesus in the flesh, but we make the very same confession. You are my Lord and my God. Let's stand together. There's one true and living God. That one God is known to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But his supreme revelation is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. And that's why when we pray in Jesus' name, demons are cast out. That's why when we pray in Jesus' name, sickness flees. That's why when we baptize in Jesus' name, sins are washed away. That's why when we call the name of Jesus in faith, people receive the Holy Spirit. God answers prayer in the name of Jesus because in Jesus dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him. If all you know is Jesus, you know enough to get healed tonight. If all you know is Jesus, you know enough to get saved tonight. You can have your life changed by the power of the name of Jesus. If you didn't understand everything I said, maybe you didn't agree with everything I said. But if you learn this one thing, Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. If you call on the name of Jesus, you can be saved. You can be healed. You can be delivered. Jesus is the Son of God, yes, because he was a real man. But he's also God, because in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. I want us to praise the Lord right now. Let's call upon the name of Jesus. If somebody here tonight needs prayer, or you'd like to pray and seek God, why don't you come to the front? Why don't you speak after God? Why don't you call on him in the name of Jesus? Let's call on the Lord together right now. Praise God. Praise God.
I'm wishing I could see the finish line, where it ends, where it lands. Guess I lost my vision when the pain set in. Can I believe when I don't see? Can I really let it be? Out of my hands, when it's out of my hands. This isn't what I choose, but it's where I'm finding you. But I'm broken and undone, your mercy's just begun. You overcome my doubt, your hands are reaching out. You hold me through the storm, and I will fear no more. But I know where you have been. Before me, after, and always within. Can I believe when I don't see? Can I believe? says it's out of my hands. Oh, this isn't what I choose, but it's where I'm finding you. But I'm broken and undone, your mercy's just begun. You overcome my doubt, your hands are reaching out. You hold me through the storm, and I will fear no more.
Thank you.
books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
When they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, each of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins.